During the winter of 1969, the railway was being battered by snowstorms and strong winds, so services on the line had been postponed until the weather improved. The engines, holed up at Mearcombe, were, as per usual, complaining. "Ugh, I hate snow." "I know, right? Horrible cold, wet stuff. It messes with my traction motor when it gets too cold like this. Besides, it's way too cold out there to expect passengers to stand around waiting for services." "True that. There really would be no point going out there with all the snow and wind anyway. And the ice as well. Ice makes it so difficult to shunt. You have to go at walking pace just so you don't slide along and cause an accident. And it's never an easy time for us shunting diesels anyway." "I quite agree. Even with our sanding gear, it can be difficult to keep trucks in order on icy rails. We have to be ever so careful, especially if we have a long train of wagons at Soma and we have to venture out onto the incline."
"I remember working up in the Peak District in the 1950s. The snow up there you'd hardly believe. Piled high on the sides of the line thanks to the track gangs. It made me terrified to work too hard when passing them, in case I caused too much vibration and caused an avalanche."
"Snow once caused me to have to wait 3.5 hours at a lonely junction in the middle of nowhere, because the line ahead was blocked and the connection service I was waiting for was delayed because of frozen point work."
"Well, I quite like snow, actually. I'd rather enjoy going out with my snowplough and seeing everything covered in snow. It's very attractive, you know, especially in the evening."
"Well, I can't argue with that. It does make everything look very pretty, but practically speaking..."
As the engine continued to discuss the dangers of snow and ice, Dave glanced at Ed, grinning.
"Hey Ed, why don't you tell them the story of why you hate cold weather so much, and in particular, snowplows, and your old pal, 44826.
Ed looked supremely uncomfortable as everybody looked towards him.
I'd rather not talk about that."
"Why not? It's not like we've got anything else to talk about. Besides, we can help you. We were there too, remember?"
"But it's kind of embarrassing."
Why? What happened?
"What's wrong with snowplows? Did you break one?"
"Go on, Ed, tell us."
There were murmurs of agreement all around the shed, as everybody stared at Ed expectantly.
Fine. I'll tell you, but you two have got to help me. I can't remember everything that happened that day."
"All right, then.
Sure, why not?"
"Right, then. Settle down, everyone. I'll tell you what happened."
As you all know, myself, Sid and Dave worked on the Somerset and Dorset Joint Railway during the mid-1950s. It was a rather busy section of line, running from Bournemouth to Bath, via the flatlands of Dorset and the Mendip Hills. Coal traffic was the main export, but passenger trains were important too. As you can probably tell, the line had a strong Midland region feel when it came to locomotives and rolling stock, despite much of the infrastructure being of southern region origin. In 1956, things were beginning to change, with the Western region moving in slowly, and Western engines slowly taking over other jobs that us Midlanders used to do. Anyway, I'm getting sidetracked. When bad weather comes to the Dark Railway, and to other preserved lines, we can cancel our services. But this was not so on the old S&D. Trains had to run whatever the weather, and on the day I'm talking about, we're in the midst of a series of blizzards. The morning was decent enough. I'd bunked off work to chill with Sid, who looked quite different back then, for this was before his rebuild. Anyway, we were chatting for a while about random things like, Sid, can you remember?
Yeah, we were talking I told you, Sid, donkeys do not make good substitute for horses.
Why not? They're basically horses, just a bit smaller and smellier.
Yes, but they do have the horsepower of a horse.
I see what you did there.
Congratulations, you win the award for most blatantly obvious comment of the year.
Ha ha! Well, what would you say makes a good substitute for a horse?
A whale.
What?
Think about it. A whale can swim thousands of miles, and they're huge. So why can't we take good train to the docks, load all the goods inside a whale, and export it to America, or Malaga, or wherever?
How are you going to control a whale?
Well, that would be something we'd have to...
Oh! Look who it is!
From the yard entrance came three engines. First came a big Fowler 7F, who was known as Number 5. Then there was my brother, Number 44422, known by us normal engines as Fowler. He was shunting a very familiar face into the sheds. You, Dave.
Yup. I remember that. I'd been hauling a parcel train up to Midsummer, and my regulator had jammed shut just outside the station. And luckily, Number 5 and Fowler were heading back this way, so they brought me down to Temple Coombe so I could be fixed. Anyway, the three of them arrived into the yard and told us what had happened. Well, well, well. What's happened here then, Number 5?
45101 here has been failed with a jammed regulator.
Hey, pal. I told you thousands of times. My name's Dave.
Sorry, 45101.
Anyway, we're going to dump him here with you till he can get fixed.
We have a half-hour break before our next service, so we might as well have a quick rest with you before getting back to work.
Fair enough.
Wait a minute. Ed, why are you still here? You were supposed to be at Radstock 2 hours ago. The jock's going nuts.
No, it's my day off today.
No one gets a day off on a Saturday, you pillock. It's far too busy.
Well, I'm a special case. A head case, more like it. Hey, fuck you, Sid.
Now, 44430, 40590.
Stop calling me by my number, 5. Why don't you get yourself a name?
I'm perfectly happy with being addressed by my number, thank you.
Yeah, well, it gets annoying when you keep doing it to us engines who have bothered to get names.
I do apologise.
Soon, the yard foreman came over to speak to Dave.
Now, Number 45101. Your crew are going to have to wait until you have cooled, and then they will inspect your regulator valve. You should be back in service by this evening, as long as we can solve the problem.
Yes, sir.
Meanwhile, Number 44430...
It's Ed.
Ed, then. You will be piloting the next passenger service to Bath, with Number 45101's replacement, Number 44826.
I was absolutely appalled. Of all the engines who we worked with on the Somerset and Dorset line, 44826 was my least favourite. He irritated me something rotten, for he was nervous and scared of anything and everything. To top it off, he was very safety critical. Really? Of all the engines on the railway, I have to work with him?
Yes, indeed. You will also be fitted with a snowplough, as the weather up north is getting worse, so we need to take precautions.
I'll give you precautions.
No argument, Ed. Do as you're told.
And with that, he walked away, as my crew went to prepare a snowplough. I was furious. 44826? 44826? Really? Can't you take the train, Number 5?
I'm afraid not. I've got my stopping freight service to take in 10 minutes with Number 44422 here.
Ha ha ha! Have fun, Ed.
Screw you. Why can't you do it, Sid? I'm not even ready for work yet, Ed. My fire's not built up enough to go out yet. Ugh. 10 minutes later, Number 5 and Fowler left, while my crew fitted the god-awful, bulky, irritating snowplough. I was so cross about the whole thing that I was late leaving the yard. We did feel some sympathy for your mind. Yeah, though I wasn't that bothered. Rather you than me, working with 44826. I wouldn't have minded if I was piloting you, though, but I would still have been cross about the snowplough anyway. Well, it's a good job that I didn't take the train then, isn't it? Go on, Ed. So I rolled back into Temple Coombe Station, cursing as I went, as the snowplough was uncomfortable on my buffers. I had to wait in the loop for the next service to arrive, which had to reverse from the lower line into the station. The two engines rolled the coaches into the platform. I recognised them. One was a bullied Pacific called Wilton, and the other was another Fowler 7F, Number 53802. The two engines sidled up along me in the station, pushing the heavy coaches in, both looking exhausted. I was surprised. What's wrong with you two? Why are you so exhausted? That part of the line's flat.
There's ice and snow everywhere. We've been slipping all the way up here.
No, you've been slipping all the way up here. On level gradients, I ask you.
Says you, old-timer, treating any downhill section like a water slide.
Old-timer, indeed? What cheek? I carried you all the way up here.
Yeah, at like 5 miles an hour.
We're only half hour down.
That's half an hour I could have been resting.
Laziness. Sheer laziness.
Hey, shut it.
I'm glad when these two headed off the train and into the shed to continue their argument. But then I remembered that 44826 would be here in a moment. As expected, he rolled up to the front of the train and coupled up. He spotted me and I groaned.
What's wrong with you?
Oh, nothing.
I see you have a snowplow.
I hate it.
Now, four thirty. It's better to be safe than sorry.
I'll give you safe. So I backed down in front of him, not concentrating and not caring very much, and the snowplow was digging into my buffer beam once again. I bumped into 44826.
Watch it! I will be reporting this.
Go on then, see if I care. Of all the engines I could have been rotted with, it had to be you. 44826 didn't reply to that. The guard waved in flag, and we were off. Me in front hardly doing any work at all, while 44826 complained about the weight of the train. I smiled a little as we headed north. As we hurried along, the snowplow kept banging my front end, and I was in awful pain. My buffer beam was sore, and my buffers themselves were aching with its weight. As we departed Evercreech Junction, I noted that there was hardly any snow on the line at all, so having a snowplow felt rather pointless. I complained to the crew, who simply laughed and we climbed the hills. As we proceeded, I banged and shook the snowplow, trying to throw it off, but of course it wouldn't come off, and the pain was getting worse and worse. 44826 kept on trying to encourage me, but he didn't have to wear a stupid snowplow. When we arrived at Shepton Mallet, I was in agony, and my crew came to inspect me. Ooh, this isn't good at all. What's wrong, Kyle? The snowplow had been banged out of shape by Ed, and now it's causing damage to his front end. That's why he's in pain. Can't you just take it off? Well, it depends. I'll go speak to the station master and the signalman, see what they think. You'll be no good to anyone if this plow warps your front end any further.
You're going to cause us to be late.
I'd rather be late than have a warped front buffer beam. Why don't you try wearing the snowplow, eh, 44826?
But you're the pilot engine. You have to.
Shortly my driver returned. All right, Ed. We're going to take the plow off. There is snow, but another train ahead of us has plowed it out of the way, so we should be safe. Excellent.
I think this is a bad idea.
Shut it, you. We'll go fast so we can make up for lost time, and so I can have a nice rest at Bath.
No. Absolutely not. I'm not risking it.
Well, if you won't, I will. And I snorted away. I think 44826 was rather taken aback at that, for he soon started helping too. Things went well, for a very short while. What none of us had realised is that, at Masbury, the summit of the line, the last train to pass before us had slipped on the rails, which had caused such a loud noise that snow had shaken loose from the cutting and had fallen over the tracks near a bridge once they'd left. We were heading for disaster, but nobody knew it. As I charged through Masbury Station, I called back to 44826. See? Nothing bad's happened. We'll be there in no time. But I hadn't reckoned with the fresh snowdrift. As we charged over the top, I saw it. I whistled, and my driver applied the brakes, but we had been travelling too fast to stop in time. I ploughed straight into the drift, up to my frames in snow. The train had stopped abruptly, and passengers shouted in surprise. 44826's driver had fallen over in the cab, and his fireman had almost fallen out. My crew had seen in time and had braced themselves, and as my fireman went to helping colleagues, 44826 laid into me.
I told you to keep that snowplow. And now look where we are. Stuck in a snowdrift. We're going to be stuck here for ages. And I'm going to be late.
Stuff being late? I'm freezing.
Serves you right for banging that snowplow.
Once everybody was discovered to be alright, the The crew decided to try and reverse us out of the snowdrift, but I was so deeply buried that I couldn't move my wheels. 4426 tried hard, but the weight of the train on the hill, combined with the slippery rails, prevented him from moving more than a few feet backwards. We were well and truly stuck. The guard ran back to Masbury to tell them what had happened. All the while, I was stuck with 4426, who was waffling on about lack of safety measures and about how late we were going to be. I didn't care about any of that. I was now more worried about Sid and Dave seeing me in this state and finding out what had happened to us. But of course, they did. Back at Templecombe, my regulator had finally been fixed, and Sid was steamed up ready for the afternoon's work. But we never got to pull our train, as the yard foreman came up to us.
Right, you two. Are you serviceable?
No. Yes, sir.
I need you two to head up to Masbury. There's been an accident. The 1455 is stuck in a snowdrift, so I need you two to go up there and rescue them.
That's Ed's train, isn't it? And 4426's. Well, we'd better go and take the piss out of them. Agreed. So we set off to the rescue. When we arrived at Masbury Summit, Ed was being lectured by 4426 and the passengers were freezing. We brought the train back into the station while Sid went to help 4426 pull Ed free from the drift. Once he'd been dragged out, we deposited Ed at Masbury. His fire had gone out and he was freezing. We didn't take the mickey just then because we knew the passengers would need to get to Bath sooner rather than later. So myself and Sid took the train onwards while 4426 slowly and crossly dragged Ed back to Templecombe. Later that night, we arrived back at Templecombe. Ed had been steamed up again and was stood in his shed alone. We rolled up beside him and I couldn't help myself. Ha ha ha! You Bang Snowploughs! Shut up! Feeling a bit frosty, are we? It's snow joke, snow ploughing, is it? Assholes. So for the rest of the evening, me and Sid ripped the shit out of him for being so careless in the snow and for being stuck up at the summit with 4426 for so long. After that, Ed wasn't called upon to do snow ploughing anymore. Instead, that job, ironically, went to 44826, who was adamant that he would put safety first from that point onwards. But he never let Ed down for it. He'd constantly remind him of the day he was stuck out there with him, freezing solid in the snow, all because he banged the snow plough too much. And that is why Ed hates snow ploughs so much. The engine's merely dead. That was rubbish! I thought something amazing was going to have happened. Let down much? Oh, I'm so sorry that my story didn't entertain you all. Next time, I'm sure you can all entertain me with your stories of grave peril and excitement and... what, like the time Owen took over the railway? I'd really rather not be reminded of... What was that? You took over the entire railway? I didn't know that. How in all that is holy did you do that? Hostile to take over? Go on, Owen. Enlighten us with your exciting story of how you beat Mr. Dark into submission, got into his office and forced everyone to do your evil bidding. It didn't happen like that. You've got to understand, this happened years and years ago, when I was just a young, naive, idiotic diesel. It was early 1960, and myself and Ryan had just made a historic run by pulling the express along the line.